So I want to talk about businesses as missions today. And so let me go ahead and just define it. So what's business as missions? Okay, so I'm going to give a quick, simple definition for how I would define it. And it's basically, it's engaging in business for the sake of reaching unreached people groups all around the world. So that's basically my thesis, and I'm going to focus on that, right? I want you guys to engage in business for the sake of reaching unreached people groups all over the world. So the first thing I want to say is, what business as missions is not? So it is not business as evangelism, okay? And it's not, because I want to put a clear delineation between evangelism and missions. So when you do missions overseas, do you evangelize? Absolutely. So they're very similar activities, but the way I would define it differently, and I didn't come up with this, I just ripped this off of other people whom I learned it from, would be the emphasis on crossing cultural boundaries, okay? And so that's the main difference between evangelism and missions. You have to cross cultural boundaries. Now, a lot of people will say you don't need to travel in order to do that. And think about it, how many people groups come to LA, right? But I would beg to differ. I think that you still need to travel, and you actually need to leave America for the majority of the times, at least, in order to do this. And my argument for it's very simple. Okay, so I'm Chinese American. When I go to China, I'm neither Chinese nor American. I'm Chinese American. When I'm here in America, I'm not completely American, I'm still Chinese American. So Chinese does not equal Chinese American, it does not equal an American. It's a separate culture in and of itself. Or another way to put it is, I'll call this the McDonald's test, okay? So if you go to McDonald's in Roland Heights, they'll have a Korean version and a Chinese version of the name, like McDonald or something like that, right? They may even have a different translation for the menu, right? But it's actually still the exact same menu. So I kind of group all of us here in America still semi in a certain way as one culture. But once you leave America and you go to China or you go to Japan, there's a vastly different menu altogether. So when there's a different menu, it's a far more different of a culture than what we have here. So it's not good enough to just say, let's just reach Chinese people in America, because you're not reaching Chinese people, you're reaching Chinese Americans. If you really want to reach Chinese people, you have to go to China. Okay. So so let me emphasize some more on this local versus global aspect. So compare Chick-fil-A versus McDonald's, right? Both are restaurants you can eat at, but McDonald's is much more international than Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A has one menu, it's in America. When you go to their website and you click on locations, it's all, you know, states, different states in the US. Right, so it's vastly different. Then think of Coca-Cola, right? Look at how many markets Coca-Cola is in. Look at how much more viral Coca-Cola is versus, say, a business that's just local. And another way to look at it is, even Coca-Cola itself, the very drink is different depending on the country you're in. In some countries, they use sugar. In other countries, they use something else. So they even have to change the product. So it changes the dynamics of the business. Okay, so it's got to be something that's much more evangelism-focused. It's got to focus on actual missions. And if you want to actually focus on missions, then you have to go overseas. It has to be more broad than just a local business, like a local coffee shop that focuses on, you know, XYZ. Another thing I want to say it's not is, business missions is not workplace ministries. I want you guys to think of something that it's not that. Okay, it includes that, but it's much more than that. So what I consider workplace ministries, right? So fundamentally, we have to understand that work is good, right? And how do we know that work is good? Because God gave us work before the fall. Hence, it's good, right? You guys all know this from Genesis. So work is good. We know that. Work does good, right? The things that you do at work have an awesome output. You work at a hospital, kids get better as a result most of the time. It's part of God's common grace. If you're a government official, God uses that, Romans 13, for the common good. So work in itself, not only is work good because God made it before the fall and called it good, work does good for us even now. I mean, somebody had to make this mic, somebody had to, you know, work and put this roof over our heads, somebody had to, you know, put the pipes in so we can get water, right? So it's absolutely, but it's more than this stuff. Another thing is, work for workplace ministries, it emphasizes that who we work for is for Jesus, Colossians 3. Okay, so it's absolutely that. We work for Jesus. It's not for your boss. It's not for the man. It's for the man. That's who we work for, right? So we have that. And it's more than just being a city on a hill, more than being just salt of the world. It's more than all these things, all right? So let me give you an example. I don't want to just define it with you guys with boring propositions. I want to tell you guys by a clear example. So in examples of business missions, first thing I want to go for is I want to talk about group businesses missions and individual businesses missions. So let me talk about the group first, okay? So a couple years ago, my wife and I, we went to Hawaii. And I forgot which island we're on, and we were just tourists, so we're just chilling out, and a bus comes by that says, you know, the Polynesian Culture Center, you gotta go. So my wife had nothing to do, so we're like, okay, let's go. So we go there, and it's kind of like Disneyland or SeaWorld or the San Diego Zoo. It was huge. There were masses of people. And my wife and I shelled out probably like $150, possibly more. I don't remember how much we spent. And we went in, and it was divided, I think, into 8 islands. And each island focused on a specific people group. And there were these guys, you know, dressed up, and they're, you know, speaking their own language, doing their thing. They're talking about coconuts here. And at this point, a guy's actually climbing up a coconut tree. You can't see it, but he's right smack in the middle. There's a guy climbing up. And then, you know, we're seeing imitation, you know, artifacts, blah, blah, blah. We're having a blast. And afterwards, we go and we eat this pig that's cooked on the ground. It's very cultural from some island. They do that. And it was just really fun. And while we were there, I noticed something. Well, the first thing they do is they split us off into small groups. So it's your tour guide. And my tour guide took us around, and she, you know, called us cousins, blah, 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 et cetera. And she lost her badge. So she had a different badge on that would get her in the park. And it was a BYU badge. So I couldn't understand why my tour guide with a BYU badge could come in for the Polynesian Culture Center. And I did some more research. And what I realized was, so the Polynesian Culture Center, it's owned by the Mormons. It's right next to BYU, Hawaii. It employs 1,300 employees, and 70% of them are BYU students, which means they're only there for a couple years. They're on 42 acres of land. They've been there since the 60s, 1963 to be exact, and they've been trying to do this since the 40s and 50s. So somebody in the 1940s and 50s, when some LDS chapel burnt down, they like did some cultural thing and they used that money to rebuild their chapel. And somewhere, somebody thought about this and said, hey, we can make some money out of this and we could fund missions, right? And they did that. And today they have about, up to today they have about 32 million visitors since the 60s. And I try to do some math on how much money that is. I couldn't. Well, my guess is probably about $50 million a year. Now, it gets even cooler than this, what they figured out how to do. So in 1991, I found an article about them. At that point, they were making about $30 million. $25 million of it was tax-free. How ingenious is that? And all the students that go to school there, in order to work outside the campus, they have to get a work visa. But because it's an on-campus job, they don't even need a work visa. So it's basically all the laws that exist in America, they leverage in order to take advantage of this. So they have a bunch of students. And what happens when they come here for 4 years? Who from those islands would not want a 4-year education in America, right? They want that. It's funded by tourists. And then those same people who are indoctrinated for 4 years go back to their islands and work and get more kids, right? How ingenious is this, right? And when I saw this, it made me think of Luke 16. This is what Jesus says. For the sons of this world, and I consider that the sons of this world because they don't see Jesus the same way we see Jesus. But the sons of this world are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than the sons of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of unrighteous wealth. Use the money you have right now with you so that when it fails, they may receive you into the eternal dwellings. And I just kept thinking, wow, why haven't Christians done this? Because we're not smart. We're not shrewd. That's basically what Jesus just said. We're not as shrewd as the sons of the world. But obviously Jesus said that, meaning we don't have to stay that way, right? Otherwise he wouldn't tell us that, right? So I'm sad, but that's the best example of business's missions I can think of, because they've been around for decades and they make millions of dollars and they're very missional and it's very global. So that's one example. Another example I have is this company called Beijing New Day Creations. It's awesome. You can Google them. So I found them, and what they did was in the early 90s, when China was just opening up, they went overseas, and in a one-car garage, they started making magnets. And what kind of magnets did they manufacture? They manufactured magnets that said, "Pray for China." How cool is that? The Chinese government, right, that oppresses the house church, allowed these guys to go in there and make magnets that say, "Pray for China," right? Because they're making money. So they send the magnets over, and they did that. And then they started to expand. And they're in the outskirts of Beijing, and there's this piece of land that nobody in China would want to buy. They considered that land cursed. And they bought it. And they took this cursed land, and they built an orphanage around it. And they made this orphanage focus on kids with extreme medical needs that other orphanages would not take. And they didn't find out until after they built the orphanage that years before they got there, there was this elderly Chinese man that would go to that site and always pray that foreigners would come, buy that land, and that this dark piece of land would one day be a light to the world, and that somebody would build an orphanage on it. And he died, and about 5 years after he died, then these white guys came in and bought this piece of land. So it's awesome. So by 2004, they expanded beyond just manufacturing and taking care of orphans to also helping college students learn English in 2004. And today, they have about 200 Chinese staff members. And I looked on their website, I looked at the kids that they take care of and the extreme medical conditions that they have, these kids that nobody would want, that would just be cast aside because they have Down syndrome or they have other medical needs. And so I think it's awesome that they did that. And they did it through business. So that's from the group side, all right? So how do you do it from an individual perspective? So the website I'll tell you guys to go to is go to goliveserve.org. I know the people who run this, and they've been doing this for decades. And what they would do is they would basically analyze the skill set that you have here and say what global international company would want that same skill set overseas. And they would try to get you over there. And once you get over there, they would set you up, and they would encourage you, and they would check up on you and make sure that you're doing what you claim you want to do. So lots of us can go do this. We can go work overseas. We can teach there. We can do many things. So you can check out that website. So I've defined business's missions, and now I want to define the necessity of business's missions. Why do we have to do this, right? So one reason is just the Great Commission. Jesus said we need to all be involved in missions. And the reality is 99% of us, well, maybe not at Biola, but in a normal church population, 99% of the people who go to that church are not going to be paid staff, right? So we have to engage in business. We have to get a job elsewhere. So that's one reason for why business. Another reason is it's just globalization. The world is a lot smaller now than it ever was. Everything you own, every piece of clothing that you own, every car you've ever been in, every iPad, every Apple product you've ever bought was not built by one single country. It required, like, think of an iPad, right? It says, designed in California, assembled in China, right? And where did the parts come from? South Korea, from Samsung, ironically, and from Taiwan, and from a gazillion other countries. That's just your iPad. Your car that's made in America, really? Look at where the parts came from. Your car that's made in Japan. Really? It's not made in Japan. It's not made just in America. It's made all over the world. Or let me show you the effect of globalization and just how we fight wars these days. Look at Russia and Germany over Crimea. I don't even know how to pronounce it. I've never heard it. I've only read it. I don't watch the news much. I read it. And there's an issue right now because between Germany and Russia, they do 76 billion euros in trade each year. So Russia gives Germany gas and oil, and Germany gives them high tech, right? So it's balanced. So because of this trade, everyone's really uneasy about doing anything, right? And if you think about that, that's also true, not just at the national level, but at a local level. So I run a software company called LifeRay, and we have offices all over the world. And there are people, no matter how much I dislike them, right, I cannot help but work with them. I have to engage with them. And business forces dialogue. And when that dialogue is colored by the love of Christ, it's redeeming. And you just have this. It's not like a short-term mission trip where you go to Mexicali, you meet these kids, and then you leave, and then you say you're going to be Facebook friends with them, but you're not, and then you never talk to them ever again. In business, you have to. In the same way that Russia and Germany have no choice because they're dependent on each other. Or to use an illustration of how globalization has changed things, if the world is a human body, business is its blood. It flows, business flows everywhere. And as Christians, we can ride that current and go throughout all over the world because of globalization. So I think of New Day Creations. Why did China let them in? Because they wanted their money. By them being there and employing Chinese people to make those magnets, there were fewer people unemployed there. And the very people who went over there, they had to eat. They had to get a place to live. So China welcomed them, even if they did not welcome traditional missionaries. So the reality is the world wants your money. So why don't we shrewdly use money to build up friends for ourselves, right? It's going to be gone anyway, so let's use it. And they want your expertise. So go leverage it while we have it. Another thing is, I've been thinking of is for why we have to do it through businesses, it's because the rules are changing, okay? So I love Hudson Taylor, okay? He broke a lot of the rules of his day. He was an innovator, or you could call him a maverick. Anyways, what he did was he forced his missionaries to wear Chinese clothing. They had to do the hair in the Chinese way. And that broke the rules. Why? Well, what got foreigners into China in the first place? It was colonialism. So colonialism got us there, but every vestige of colonialism became a barrier for people becoming Christians. So he had to throw away the very thing that got us there, right? So okay, so colonialism, the opening of the world, finding new trade routes got us there. But once we got there, we got to get rid of that very same thing, put on Chinese dress, and witness, right? So the very rules that got us there were no longer helpful. And what that means is today, there are rules today in the way we do missions today that were very helpful in the past and got us to where we are today, but they will not help us for tomorrow. And we have to learn to let some of those rules go away. And you guys are young. That means the people who hold power today, whether they like it or not, they will grow old and die. And when they do, you guys will rise up and take their place, and you guys will be able to make decisions that they completely disagree with. But let's do it in a way that's flavored with the gospel that honors God. So let me give you an example of something that is in charge today that probably does more harm than good, right? So back in the day, in order to do anything, you needed large agencies. You needed to consolidate them. Why? Because you didn't have Skype. You didn't have airplanes. You didn't have 1,000 things that we have today. And so we have these very, very large agencies. And I've talked to a bunch of missionaries from there, and this is what they often tell me. This is a rule I've come up with. They'll say, on the field, you can usually divide it this way. 25% of the people that are on the field with traditional missionaries are extremely competent in what they do. They're awesome. The other 25% enable that 25% to do their jobs. 25% are there because they're just living overseas. They're not really missionaries. And the last 25% make it very, very difficult for the best 25% to do their job. So why don't large agencies get rid of the bottom 25, right? Or the other 25? Because this is how it works. When somebody raises funds and you pay for them, right? A cut goes to the agency. So the agency has no motivation to get rid of bad people. As long as they can raise the funds, they're taking a tax of that for the common organization. So there's a financial incentive not to. But at one point in time, you needed these large organizations. But what I've seen now is that with technology, a lot of small churches, 150 people, 300 people, they can do the exact same stuff that used to require a 5,000-person agency to do. So we can be smaller, more nimble. We don't have to wait for a top-down approach. We can go back to the local church. We can do things in an easier fashion. Here's another perspective. What's the average lifetime of a missionary, right? In reality, the average lifetime of a missionary is 5 years, okay, of a lifetime missionary. But all the books that we read, the people we admire, are people who spent 30 to 60 years there. And why did they spend so much time there, right? And I'm not saying you shouldn't do that, please. If God calls you to spend 30, 60 years in a foreign place, please do so, right? But the reality is, whether we put those people on a pedestal or not, the reality is most people are not spending that much amount of time. They're spending 5 years. So why do we do that? Because back then, in order to travel over there, it took you 6 months on a boat. Now it takes you 24 hours, right? So we have these rules in place, and we encourage certain things that no longer work in this day and age. Another one is, you just look at missions giving in general. Every search you do online shows that overall missions giving is going down, right? It's happening. So why don't you fund yourself instead? If that's the trend, why do you have to? And imagine you go to an agency and somehow you can't raise enough funds, or because you're not a good fundraiser, or somehow you go to an agency where they, you know, allocate the pool of money from all the local churches in the denomination, and then they fund missionaries that way, like a military approach. Suppose they do it that a very large monolithic organization, and then they don't have enough budget, so they can't send you. So now you're not going to go as a missionary. Why don't you fund yourself? Is it really that hard to go online and apply for a position overseas? No. So we can break the rules that exist today and do things differently for the purpose of spreading the gospel. Okay. Besides business missions being necessary, I want to talk about the dangers of it. And these are things I've experienced over time. So one of the toughest things about business missions is accountability. You have no elder board. So if you're a pastor, you have an elder board who can keep you accountable. If you own a company, who's going to keep you accountable? You can do whatever you want. I guess if you have shareholders, but they're not going to care whether you're doing missions or not. They just want to make sure there's a profit. All right, so how do you do that? So what we do is, from the very beginning of when we started LifeRay, we made sure that there was a division of power. No one person could make a unilateral decision. We forced there to be a plurality of voices in making a decision, because we assumed that all of us are corrupt. Another danger is no one's praying for me, right? Because imagine you decide to work for Apple and you go to Shanghai, and you go there and you feel like you're just getting beat up all day. Well, if you're going to go work overseas, do it as if you were a missionary. Write letters to your church. Tell them, hey, pray for me as I'm over there. These are my goals. Help me achieve them. Another one may be, I feel lonely when I'm over there. I'm beat up. So find an agency, like Go Live Serve. Work with them. They'll connect you. They'll make sure, they'll do the parts that an agency is very good at doing. Another thing I constantly struggle with is money. Okay. how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of heaven, right? What happens when you do business and the business ticks off? It makes money, and it makes more money, right? So what do you do with the fact that you make more money, right? So what I do is I try to put myself in a tough situation. So if we're spending this much, I try to if we're making this much money, I try to expand the business to this to this much. Make more, go more, so that you never build up enough of a bank account that you can do anything on your own. And I do this because I just remember David. When David was running away from Saul, he had a couple hundred guys with him, but when he was running away from Saul, he was way less likely to engage in Bathsheba-like activities than when he had other people go and fight wars for him. So you have to do that. And then the other thing that's really difficult is the very desire of wealth can cloud your desire for missions. What if you're simply saying, oh, I want to do missions, but you really just want more money? How do you deal with that heart desire that's in every single one of us, right? That desire that kills, right? And shipwrecks faith. What do you do? So the way to combat that is to give as much away of it as you can, to share with those that you have in need, and to limit what you will spend money on. Another thing that's related to money that I constantly struggle with is you worry about competitors. That's the thing with business. If you do well, you can get prideful. If you do poorly, you worry about competitors. And look at how God shaped Israel. He always made sure that there were the Philistines, that there were all these guys around just about to attack them, to get them to remember. And so I feel that way a lot of times. I feel like there are these competitors that can like wipe us out. We have a couple hundred employees. They have a couple hundred thousand employees. We have a couple $1 million. They have a couple $1 billion, right? And so the way you combat that is when you're in those situations is when risk comes and it feels really scary and danger comes, what I usually do is instead of running away, what I try to do is trust in the Lord, right? Not in your understanding. Cast your burdens on God. Humble yourself, right? By casting your burdens on Him because He cares for you. And then I run toward the risky thing. So I'll give you an example. A bunch of our competitors were taking out venture capital. And that venture capital money would be like $50, $70 million of a war chest that they would do, that they would take in order to build the same stuff we have to destroy us. And we could do two things. We could do the exact same thing they did and also take money, but then lose control. Or we can say, screw this. We'll run right into the danger, and we won't take the money, and we'll just operate and see what happens. And so oftentimes, when I see this type of stuff, I'll just do what the dangerous thing is, and it usually works out, because I think God likes that. The other thing is, there's a danger for us who do business missions for acting the way that makes us seem alive, but we're really dead. Like, I'm here. I'm just a software engineer. Why am I here? Because I have a reputation for running a software company that does business missions. But what if I'm really just dead inside? What if Jesus comes and says to me, Brian, you have a reputation for being alive, but I have found your works lacking. Strengthen what remains and is about to die. What if He says that to me at the very end of my days? So I try to keep that constantly in front of my mind so that I don't psych myself out and think, wow, I'm doing ministry when I'm really not. So I want to remember what I've been given by God. I want to keep the gospel, and I want to repent. Another big danger is from doing businesses, we oftentimes, in business, you're making something, right? Whether you're a doctor or you're you write software, whatever you do, you're making something. And it's very easy for us to say, behold the work of our hands, Hosea 14:3, all right? We worship what we make. When the very thing that God gave us, the ability to do work, right, for common grace, right, for good, we take that and we worship the work of our hands. And the way I combat that is, I just remember what an iPod looks like. Do you remember the first iPod with the little wheelie wheel, right? Or remember an iPhone 4S, right? How old that thing looks? It doesn't have the right square resolution, right? Compared to iPhone 5, it looks so gross, right? Or imagine, and once the iPhone 6 comes out, right? We're gonna feel the same way about an iPhone 4S. Look how quickly that stuff goes. Everything that we build here, it's just like sandcastles. It's gonna get washed away. At least from the perspective of the world, right? Perhaps if it's done with a gospel flavor, that God will choose to make it last for eternity. Another one is, a lot of us, I think especially guys, we find our identity and our satisfaction in work. But just remember what God said in Jeremiah, right? My people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, the fountain of living waters, and they have hewn out cisterns for themselves, broken cisterns that can hold no water, right? We find our satisfaction, and it's so easy for me. Yes, I'm doing this business missions at LifeRay. Where am I finding my real satisfaction? Am I finding it in God or not? And the way to do it is drink from Jesus. Another real danger is persecution. I want to talk about a family that I read about recently. Ronnie Smith, so he listened to a sermon from John Piper, and he took his wife and this kid, Hosea, and they moved, to Libya. Yeah, Libya. He lived there for 18 months. He was married for over 10 years. He had a master's in chemistry. He chose not to get a seminary degree. He chose not to pursue his PhD so he could move over there, live in a dangerous place, and use his chemistry skills to engage in people. And these secular articles that wrote about him basically said, you know, when everyone else gave up on us, he would come in and would continue to teach us, and he actually cared for us and loved us. Right here, I'll read it. He was a teacher who offered free private tutoring when others had given up, they said. Smith pushed them, demanding hard work and success. He was not a pushover, a chemistry teacher, where the chemistry teaching was just a front. He was a real good chemistry teacher, and he made sure that his kids knew their chemistry, right? And then what happened? This story always rips at me because I have a kid his age. When I look at his kid's hands, I see my kid's hands, and I've been married over 10 years, right? And look at the price they paid. I think what happened was, as a country, we found some bad guys, I think we either killed some or we took some away. So other bad guys says, well, because America's hurting our bad guys, we're gonna go kill all Americans. And he happened to just be running, and he was killed. And he went overseas and he did business missions. And I want to encourage you guys to go and be willing to do that. Another family that really moved me is Matt and Grace. By the way, I don't even know these people. This is just information I gathered online. It's all public info. And he went to Stanford. He's Asian. I didn't go to Stanford. I went to University of Chicago, but he's an engineer. I did CS and econ, so there's just some connection. He's about my age. My wife and I, we struggled with infertility for over a decade. We have kids now. And they adopted three kids, I think from Ghana. And if you're Asian, adoption is very difficult for parents to accept because it's just against our culture. And then adopting kids who don't look Asian, even if they look Asian, they better be Chinese if you're Chinese, XYZ if you're XYZ. So they crossed the color barrier and like they just did everything. I can't imagine anyone doing this if you're Asian unless Christ is there. There's no reason to. Everything about the culture prevents it from happening. So they did that, and he worked for some engineering firm that moved to Qatar, and he moved to Qatar to help build their World Cup in 2022, their World Cup, blah, 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 okay? And when he moved there in 2012, by 2013, his youngest daughter, the youngest daughter, died. And when they adopted her, she had problems because she would always eat from the garbage. She would always just scavenge for food, or for days she would not eat. That's what she got accustomed to. And so when they joined this family, she had those tough habits that she could not let go. And so people in Qatar could not understand why Asians were adopting black kids. And they assumed, and the official charge was, you adopted these black kids to harvest their organs. That was the official charge against them. And they put him in jail. And in Qatar, could you imagine being in jail? I couldn't imagine how tough it would be being in jail in America. I could not imagine how hard it would be being in jail in a Muslim country, being separated from my wife, because I doubt they have co-ed jails there, one of my kids just died, and then they've been there since January 2013. I think a few months ago they let him do house arrest, but then he gets, and then he also got fired from his company, blah blah, etc. You can Google them and just type in Matt and Grace space free, and you'll see them. So I just wanted to bring that up because it is dangerous, but it's worth it. I'll say a little bit about myself, and then we'll go to Q&A. I graduated from UFC in 2000, and when I was in college, I spent most of my time doing ministry. My GPA was a 2.7. I hated school. I did four Bible studies at a time, not at the exact same time, but per week. I just loved ministry and evangelism, and it was not Biola, trust me. It was a very, very difficult place, and I loved it. And a bunch of pastors came to me and said, Brian, you're going to be a pastor. And I said, okay. Except one pastor came up to me and said, Brian, why don't you work for 2 years, see what it's like in the working world, and come back. He hadn't done that, so he felt that he could not relate to people in the working world. So I took his advice, and I started working. And when I started working in 2000, I also went to Urbana. And right around the same time, I kept thinking, okay, when I graduate from college, you know, 10 years is gonna be like a blink of an eye. It's gonna come and go. My life is just gonna, like a vapor, it's just gonna come and go. It's not very long. How do I maximize my time here now so that when I die, I'll be most happy? And I said, okay, I think it would be cool to be like Jim Elliot. What if I went to a people group that had never heard of the gospel, and I spent 30 years telling them and translating the gospel, and they would reject me at first, but right before I die, or after I die, the chief would accept Christ, and then for all eternity, 2,000 people would know Christ that would not know it except for me. And I would try to do it for free. And why? Because Romans 15, you want to go where no one's gone before, and Corinthians, because you want to do it for free, right? So that's what I'm thinking. But I'm like, that's the last thing I would want to do. Why? Because I hate dirty places. I make sure no one's ever sat on my toilet at home. I alcohol wipe them. Except for me and my wife, she's okay. But I'm very, very OCD. I think people from my culture, from Hong Kong, generally are that way. SARS, blah, all that stuff. So you're like, you just walk around with a, you know, mouth cover. You just try to stay away from people, right? There's germs everywhere. But what if my very lack of desire for doing these things makes it so that I'm just ignoring the Spirit from where God is calling me to move to? So at Urbana, I went to three different organizations, Wycliffe, Pioneers, and Frontiers. They have this board of unreached people groups. I'll go, send me, here's my profile. I filled it out and I sent it to them, and I just said, take me. Nervously, I'm like, God, if they take me, my girlfriend's gonna break up with me. And I'm gonna have to swap flies and have no toilet paper. Okay, but if this is what you want me to do, then I'll go do this. So I applied, and they all rejected me, to my surprise. So I tried to find out why, and basically the gist of it was, I've never gone camping, I don't know how to start a fire, and I didn't take any linguistics courses. They weren't about to spend a ton of money investing in some kid who's then gonna quit in a year, right? Because they're gonna be held accountable for those resources. Okay, so they all rejected me. And one of them came to me and said, Brian, let me show you this. And they showed me their website. I'm like, okay, that's cool. A couple pages, something, you know, it's a lot easier nowadays, but back in 2000, it was a big deal. A bunch of static HTML pages. They showed it to me, and they said, Brian, we just spent $50,000 building this. Why don't you help us build our websites? And I just kept thinking, okay, you want to use my computer skills. And then at the same time, I got connected to an organization called Gospel for Asia. And they were, and their focus is basically, and I don't completely agree with their philosophy, because their whole thing is, let's outsource missions. Let's not have you guys pay the hard work. We don't want white guys over there. Why? Because you guys will cost us $50,000 a year, plus airfare, and a pension, and healthcare. Whereas these guys, and if we send you over there, and there's something that's wrong, we're gonna have to send you to another country that has better medical care. Whereas the local people, they can just disperse amongst themselves, and it's a whole lot cheaper. Right, so that's their model, right? I don't believe in that. I think you need to go we need to go and shed our blood as well. Anyways, that's a different topic. But at that time, I partnered with them. I still partner with them. I love them. They're a good organization. So for $200 a month, you can sponsor a local Indian missionary. And I was working at a software company that was billing me out at $200 an hour. What does billing me out means? It means I work for them, they pay me significantly less, and they charge some company significantly more because now it looks cool because, wow, you're getting it from this company, right? So they did that. And the company I worked for, in the span of 18 months, blew away $42 million on under 200 people. I have no idea how they did that. I kept trying to do the math, and I realized they had an upside-down pyramid. Here I was working, and they had four levels of bosses above me. And they just did it wrong. They just did a bad business. And I learned that while my company was billing me out at $200 an hour, companies like IBM and SAP were billing out their people at $500 an hour. So they'll go to some university campus, take a kid who knows nothing, put him underneath a kid who knows a lot, and say, aha, we're IBM. So we're going to make sure that this project is done, and it will only take 10 people, but we really are going to put 30 people on your project so we can bill the other 20 people and get them to learn, and we'll bill them at $500 an hour and milk this company. And that's how business works. Okay, guys? So they did that. I'm like, wow. What if a group of Christians got together and did it right? I was just doing the math, because if we all gave 10% each, it's not the same as the corporate 10%, because you just do the math, there's all these layers of fat there, right? So what if a group of Christians did that? And right around the same, I'm just thinking like, okay, let's do a business like this. Around the same time, my pastor asked me to build a website for our church. And I kept thinking, how would I build a website for him, right? It may take me 100 hours, but if I built the foundation of it, which may cost me 1,000 hours, right, but the next church that I help will only cost me 10 hours, then eventually I'd make up my time and I end up being a better steward of my time. So I spent all this time in that 1,000 hours building this foundation. And that's the foundation of what I work on now. It's a hobby that turned into work. And from 2000 to 2004, I just kept building these parts. And for non-software people, this is how I describe it. Imagine if I asked you to go and make a chair, and I gave you an axe. It would take you forever, right? But if I gave you parts from IKEA, how long would it take you? Not very long. You just screw it all in, because they're all the same parts with different colors and different holes and a different Swedish name, right? It's all the same stuff. So what if somebody came together and made those blueprints? So that's what I did. So I kept making those blueprints, and I gave it away for free because I figured no one's going to buy these blueprints. But by 2004, there were enough companies that wanted my expertise over those blueprints. So I was able to quit my job, and I started working, and I went through my IM list, yes, because back then you use AOL Instant Messenger, and I went through that. I got my friends from college, and we started LifeRay as a company. And we dedicated the next 2 years of that to making money, to giving money toward missions. That was our goal. And we gave away hundreds of thousands of dollars. And then our hearts grew cold. Because at the end of the day, when you give money, it's sort of like transferring money like virtually over the internet. It's like virtual coins. Like, it doesn't really make a difference. I still get to eat. I still get to sleep. I still have a car. It didn't hurt. It didn't touch at the very core of my being. And I asked myself, God, right around the same time, I started meditating on the parable of the talents, right? So you think of the parable of the talents, right? What was a talent? A talent back then in the Bible signified money, and it signified about 20 years worth of money. So if you think about the average annual salary being $50,000 times 20, one talent equals $1 million, roughly. So in the story of the talents, it's somebody got 5 million talents, $5 million, somebody got $3 million, and somebody got $1 million. And each was given it according to their ability to manage that money. And so throughout the years, in the English language, we automatically associate the word talent not for a monetary measure, but for what your hands can do. Why would our society do that? It's very simple. Imagine if you're on an island by yourself, okay? You're stuck on an island by yourself, and have any of you guys watched I Am Legend, right? Okay, I'm Legend. So I remember this scene. Okay, Will Smith. I forgot his name in it. He's Will Smith in every movie, right? So Will Smith is running, and I remember the dog's name, Sam. Okay, Samantha. So the dog is running in, and he's trying to save the dog. And the dog's cowering, and he's like super scared, right? He goes in there, and right behind him are all these zombies, right, huffing and puffing. And you just want to get out of there, right? And I remember that scene, right around where he was, it was just a bunch of $100 bills. And he was at a bank vault. They were making a statement there that money is meaningless, right? If you're there by yourself on an island, money's useless because you're not going to use it for anything. Now, if there were two people there, you and your friend, then you can, you know, climb up coconut trees and do that, and the other person can swim and catch fish, right? So you guys can specialize in that. You can trade coconuts for fish. Now, imagine if there were three people on there, and the third person could do something else, okay? Forget what it is. So, three people. Imagine the first person wants what the second person has, the second person wants what the third person has, and the third person wants what the first person has, and none of them are willing to trade because none of them have what the other person wants. Now you're stuck. So money comes in as a medium of exchange to designate what you and I are capable of doing with our hands. That's all it is. What abilities do you have? Right? Back to that passage. So then we came back to ourselves and said, okay, we're giving away money and our hearts are cold. So what is it really that God has given us to do? It's not giving money. We do that simply as an exercise in faith, but it's not our core competency. We must give, but we must move beyond giving and not just give and do work with our hands. Use our time, use our talents, right? And so what do we have? We have a bunch of people downloading our software from all over the world, from places that hate Christians. So what do? Let's go open up offices there. Let's trade with them. Let's hire people there. Let's thrust ourselves into their lives, show them that we are completely competent in software, that we know that zero is not one and that one is not zero, okay? We're completely competent. We're capable of doing our work, right? Yet, we believe that Jesus Christ died and literally rose again from the dead, similar to what crazy people would believe about Santa Claus, and that's what we believe. And we go there and we engage with them and we spend lots and lots and lots of time with them. And I don't have time to go over some of those stories, but that's what we do. And today we have a couple hundred people spread across the planet. And our aim is, God willing, if he preserves us, then we just keep doing what we're doing. We're going to engage in business. And through engaging in business, through riding the current of trade, we're going to go self-fund ourselves. We're going to go to different places and hopefully do a better job than the Polynesian Culture Center in magnifying God. I left about 10 minutes for some Q&A in case I said anything heretical that I need to correct. Any questions? No questions? That's impossible. You guys all asleep? Okay, there's a guy over there. Okay, so my theory of politics is when you're engaging in business as missions overseas, stay away from all of it. Do not do anything political. Because those places that hate Christians the most don't want those type of Christians. So this is the type of Christian I'm going to be when I'm over there. I'm going to be like what Peter wanted me to be and what Paul wanted me to be. I'm going to submit to all authority. I'm going to pay all my taxes. I'm going to not do any type of insurrection behavior, nothing like that, no matter what country that is. We will obey all your laws, because that's a biblical thing to do. Now, we'll also tell them, hey, look, you don't want me to pray three times a day? You want me to bow down to this golden image? Sorry, I can't do that, all right? And in line with those things, it would be, hey, here, I worship. Jesus is not something that's just part of my life on Sundays. It interacts with everything I do. You know how your people will, there's a situation in China right now where people will hit somebody on the road and then they're injured. And instead of helping them, they'll back up the car and run them over again and make sure they're dead. Why? Because the logic is this. If they're dead, I pay a one-time fee. If they're alive, I continue paying for them. And it makes perfect sense in the ethics of their culture. But here's what I'm promising to you, XYZ leader. I'm going to support you. I'm not going to do anything that has to do with insurrection. Okay, I'm going to pay all my taxes. I'm going to completely listen to you. And I'm going to do my business in such a way that will transform your society so they won't run over each other. Right? And generally speaking, they like that. And I say this just because this is recorded, and I know some of those people are going to watch this, and I want them to know we're not against you. Please. We will obey. Any questions? Wow. You guys must be very tired from the whole missions conference. That's it? Okay, so the question is, hey, God's given me these gifts in filmmaking. I don't like dirty places, so is it okay for me to just say, hey, I'm going to take my filmmaking and use this to glorify God? Yes and no, okay? Yes in the sense that if you think about it this way, right, God has not written on a wall, Brian, go to position A5 grid, blah, blah, blah. These are the coordinates. Stay there. Click, click. He's not doing that. He is, ultimately he is doing that. I'm a Calvinist. But not, ultimately he is, but not in the Bible, like, there's no coded message there to tell me this, right? So here's how I think of it, right? I'm a hammer, okay? And Bob over there is a screwdriver. And in order to get this task done, I see a plane, a wooden plane, and I see a lot of nails, and I see a lot of screws. Did I say I'm a hammer? Yes. I will use my hammer. I can screw, but I won't. I'm going to hammer, unless the captain tells me to screw. Then I'll take the other edge of my hammer and screw it. Otherwise, I'll just hammer, and I'll let my friend use his screwdriver skills to screw in the screws. Okay? So, by and large, I believe in that. But if you ever hold on to that and say, God, I will not do this because these are my gifts, you're in deep doo-doo. Don't ever say that. Always be open. So I tell myself, God, I don't want to do these things. It could be 5 years from now, 5 days from now. He says, Brian, you're going to do that. And I will joyfully do it because I will be happiest there. And yeah. So, but generally speaking, the giftings that you have, right, given by the Spirit are for the benefit of the church. So if you can sing, sing, right? And if you can code, code. If you can film, film. There's nothing wrong with that. Okay, I have 4 more minutes, so I can do 2 more questions. Right over there. So I think the core of her question is, if I'm understanding it correctly, is the giftings that we have, is it meant simply to edify the church, or is it meant to edify the community that you live in? And I would say, in the same way that God gives grace to the entire world and gives grace to his elect, the giftings that you have ought to benefit the elect in an extraordinary measure, but also benefit the entire community because God loves the whole world. So you should do that. Help everyone as much as you can. Like, imagine if you invent some drug, right, that deals with some disease. Of course, that's going to help everyone. And it will glorify God because you'll do it in Jesus' name, right? Wouldn't that be awesome? Anyone over here? Oh, is it all girls? Oh, no. Yeah.
What's just like one example of some way you've seen God open doors for the gospel through life, particularly in other countries?
Okay, so that's a very good example. Very good question. So how do you see life rate open up doors, right? Okay, I'll give one illustration. So we were in China for about 3 years. And for those 3 years, we sent guys over there. And when we sent them over there, we literally just dropped them off. They like found a hotel and then found some apartment. And, like, they didn't even know where to go. Like, we just dropped them and said, here's a budget, like open up an office, right? And hire some people. Figure out the laws, do it everything legally, just do it, right? And we sent them. And for 3 years, after every 6 months I'd go there for about a month, I'd be like, guys, where's the ministry? Why is nothing happening? And I tried not to get involved, and then like nothing would happen. And then by the end of the 3 years, I was just mad. So I went over, and when I was there, I was really mad because there was an international church there. And when I went there, it completely blew me away because the majority of the people there were Black and Filipino in China, right? I expected to see a bunch of white people or a bunch of Asian Americans, but not Black people and not Filipinos in China. But what happened was they needed English teachers and they weren't importing enough from America, so they brought them in. Now, these places where they're coming from, they're part of the global south, right? There's 300 million Christians in Africa, right? But the problem is, as I interact with them, I realize that their faith was like 2 inches shallow, deep, like very, very shallow. And they would readily accept any other gospel. And when I was at that church, it was led by a Korean woman. Okay, so I'm a complementarian, but I did my best. I'm like, I'm going to make this work, right? And I went in there, and one day, she basically said, okay, guys, it's Mother's Day, so let's all close our eyes, and let's commune with our dead mothers, right? And at that point, I couldn't do it. I'm like, okay, guys, I can, like, have some theological thing and say unity, right? But at some point, I have to just say, okay, I can't do this. And I went to my friends, and I said, guys, let's start a competing international church, right, on the other side of the city, and let's make it biblical. And in order to go to an international church, you have to have an American passport or a foreign passport. Let's think about that. Let's just put that as an item to talk about. And so that's what I thought of doing. And my friends who are of the Korean-American context, who grew up in church splits, said, no, we're not splitting the church. Church splits are bad. We can't do this. So I was stuck. And then I came back home, and my wife's parents run a missions organization, and they target the underground church. And the underground church in China is larger than the official church, right? But the underground church and the official church, they hate each other. Just because they considered the official church Christians bandwagon Christians. Just because we're not persecuted now the way we used to be, now you're like being Christian, right? Where were you 30 years ago, right, when people were killing us for this, right? So they don't talk to each other. And so because of that fact, they can only reach out to one group, they can't reach out to the other group. But as China opens up more, the other group is actually becoming more and more prominent. So her parents said, Brian, we can't change our contacts because we defend them all, but you're doing it afresh. Why don't you target this new group? So me, my mom, because she speaks Mandarin and I don't. Me, my mom, and my wife, we went to a Three Self church. And we're like, God, how do we partner with this Three Self church? We just went over there. And I didn't understand the message. And at the end of it, there was just some board. And so my mom and I, we walk over there. And she strikes it up with one of the elders. Blah, blah, blah. They're like having a good time. And then they bring over these two ladies. And these two ladies have been praying for a year that foreigners would come, partner with them, and open up an English with Mandarin translation Bible study to help them. And then we did that. And so now, so we have people there working with Three Self Church under the governance of the Three Self Church with the permission, with the blessing of the government, and we do Bible studies. And we train them up theologically because their theology is bad. Okay, that's it. If you have any questions, you can ask these guys here. Thanks for your time.
We hope you enjoyed this message. Biola University offers a variety of biblically-centered degree programs, ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Learn more at biola.edu.